What's up, what's up, what's up? Thank you so much for pressing the play button and listening to the late night episode of the People's Paradise Podcast. First thing I'm going to tell you right now is keep in mind about the audio quality. The audio quality is going to be a little bit subpar because I'm not near my equipment right now. I'm not near my studio equipment. So if this is your first time tuning into your board, this is your first time actually taking time out of your day to click play on the computer or press play on your iPhone and listen to me, just know that the audio quality is going to be a little bit bad right now. And actually, also because I'm walking right now, I'm actually walking home right now from Starbucks. You know how the hustle is. You know, you don't have working Wi-Fi at your house, so you go to Starbucks to upload your YouTube videos and stuff like that. If you a hustler like me, you know how it is. But anyway, what's been going on with you? Me, I've just been kicking back, kicking back and kicking back up, trying to get this podcast and these videos up there. I had a really, really big disappointment today, actually. I'm actually quite frustrated right now, but I'm going to get over it. But first off, I want to ask you, what's been going on with you? What's going on in your life? What activities are taking place in your life right now? Like I always say, man, I'm JT. I'm always here to talk to you. I'm always here to have a good conversation with you. So if you take the time to press if you take the time to comment on this podcast or listen to me right now on your SoundCloud app, or listen to me right now on your podcast app on your iPhone, or if you listen to me on YouTube, whatever way you listen to me right now, just take the time to say comment and say, what's up, JT? And let me know what's going on in your life. I really want to connect with you. Like, you don't know how much I like doing this podcast and thing, because I do like to connect with people, and I do like to take the time to actually have a conversation with the people who are tuning in. So it's cool. I ain't gonna lie, with the smooth jazz music playing in the background, with me walking at night like this, it's actually pretty cool right now. I live in a really nice neighborhood, you know. Thank God it's not where I used to live. I used to live in the freaking slum, so this is really an upgrade to my regular life, so it's pretty cool. But besides that, not doing much, man. Just living life, trying to get this stuff off the ground. The big disappointment I had, I was trying to tell you about earlier, was okay. So you've been watching my YouTube videos, right? On my YouTube channel, JT's Boldest Dream. Okay, so on my YouTube videos, I've been having an issue because I have terrible quality because I've been recording the videos with my iPhone, and the video quality is okay. The video quality is okay, but it's just the audio quality be terrible. Like, it'll be terrible, but compared to the studio microphone that I'm using, you know, it's not even a comparison. It's not even a fair comparison. So what I decided to do was to go on Amazon, click up the search for an HD cam, and I bought a Logitech C615. Bought it for $41. It was like $69 at Walmart, so, you know, save $14. I thought I did good. I patted myself on the back. But I bought the camera, man. I hooked it up to my computer. I downloaded the software and everything yesterday. I thought it was going to function. I came into the library, rented out the studio room. I thought I was about to go in there and go ham. I'm talking about I was listening to T.D. Jakes and Steve Harvey and Adolf Hitler war speeches all night, talking about, nigga, I'm about to go in there and fight in my element. Because, like, see, when I see a lot of people, like, I always say this, there's a lot of people who, when they do podcasting and when they do YouTube vlogging, when they do all of that, they see it as more of like a recreational thing. They see it as like more of a thing to have fun with, you know. And me, I don't see it like that. I see it as like every time I get in front of a camera, every time I get behind a microphone, I see it like I'm putting on my armor. I'm going to war. I see myself putting on my helmet, picking up my sword, picking up my spear, picking up my shield, and marching to battle on the front line of battle to say, you know, hey, I'm here and it's time for me to have my shine. It's time for me to be victorious. So I don't take it lightly, so I was really hyped up to get up this morning to go up and do my stuff. They're coming to find out I can't even use the HD camera. So then I said, okay, cool, okay, HD camera's not going to work, okay, cool. So then I'll just record the videos with my computer laptop camera. Because even though my laptop is quite old, quite ancient, it still has a little device in the center where I can actually record videos and stuff at. So I record the videos. Audio comes out piss poor. But, I mean, audio comes out okay, but the video quality comes out piss poor because the webcam on the laptop is terrible. So, bro, I go to the Starbucks to upload the videos and stuff, and I'm like, whatever, I'm just going to upload them to YouTube and edit them in the editor. Man, I get to Starbucks, and Come to find out that the videos didn't even record the sound because my laptop's, like, camera software is just so freaking terrible. And, man, it just sucks, man. I hate that. Like, I hate when stuff like that happens to me because I'm in the process of creating great art for you, you know. You gotta understand, like, the reason I'm so sensitive about this process is because anytime that I'm taking out of my day to make content, to create great content, to create great video art, to create great conversation, it's something that I'm doing to entertain you. So I feel like when I don't take the time to make great videos, I feel like I disappointed you in some way. I feel like me and you are losing a connection because, you know, stuff isn't just going my way right now. So it is what it is. I just have to kind of just deal with that and work with what I got. My end result is I'm going to buy probably an iPhone 6 because I figured out a way where I actually could buy a USB power outlet and also be a lighting to USB cord you can hook up to the iPhone 6, and I can hook up my studio microphone to the phone. So I'm going to probably do that, but the only bad thing about that is I have to get an iPhone 6, and I'm either going to get an iPhone 6 or an iPhone 7. I'm kind of like, I'm going to be honest with you, which one do you think I should get? I'm going to tell you right now, I'll be all the way honest with you, I'm kind of, because I've been so frustrated with all my misfunctioning and malfunctioning electronic devices that I've had in the past few days, I'm thinking about getting to a space where I feel like that the next device that I buy, be it for a smartphone, be it a laptop, be it a studio microphone, I'm tired of just shopping for cheap shit. I want to start buying quality, and it's quality stuff so I can provide you with quality entertainment. You know, I'm tired of just providing you with terrible podcasts, you know? I just don't like that. So, like, for example, if I get a new phone, because because you've been listening to me for a while, I went through like 5 phones in 3 months because I kept buying these cheap ass Samsung Galaxy S4s and 5s off of eBay and Amazon, and they just all kept breaking. Then I got a freaking LG phone. I hate LG, by the way. Don't you ever get an LG phone. Don't ever get an LG phone. If there's anything that you take seriously from JT, please take this literally. Do not even walk into a Metro PCS store and look at the LG or a Verizon store. Ignore that mother effer possibly, because LG phones are terrible, man. They have terrible cameras. They have terrible lighting. You can't do nothing with them. It's literally like a headache. So that's probably what I'm gonna do. I'm getting to the point now where I'm tired of tolerating just piss poor software. I'm tired of tolerating electronic devices that don't function the way that I would envision that they would when I bought them. I'm just tired of it. So now what I'm gonna do is I'm going to start purchasing devices that I actually want. Like, the next phone I get, it's not going to be a cheap iPhone 5 or iPhone 6. Next phone I get is going to be an iPhone 7. I'm speaking that into existence. I forget who says that all the time. There's some big-time celebrity I listen to a lot who says that. I'm going to speak that into existence. I'm speaking that into existence right now. I'm getting an iPhone 7. Or if I get a new Samsung, it's going to be a Samsung 7. I'm not tolerating any more bullshit hardware. I'm tired of that. No more outdated hardware, no outdated places, even with my living situation. Like, on my path, on my artistic path, as you could call it, I've tolerated living in this sad place, but now, tomorrow, when I get up and make my podcast, when I make my videos and everything like that, I'm waging war. I'm talking about waging war. I'm not even playing with them no more. I'm talking about it's a lot of this stuff has got to stop. A lot of this stuff, like, I can't. I know I'm greater than this. Like, I know I'm greater than the situation that I'm in, and I know I deserve to be in a higher level. So that's why I'm not knocked down yet. I'm just going to keep trying and keep going at it, because I know that what I'm working for is eventually going to come into being. You know what I mean? Like, you know what I mean. Like, when you're out there, man, and you really are trying to go at your goal, trying to attain your goal, trying to attain that possession that dwells in your heart that you really, really want and really desire more than anything else in the world, there's going to be so many obstacles that stand in front of you. But I feel like that with this podcasting thing, but I can't stop. I, I gotta keep going. It's literally no option other than to keep going. Peace out, see ya. I just wish. You know, I was talking to my aunt a few weeks ago. I'm always telling you about conversations I had with my aunt. I might bring her on the podcast again. I brought her on the podcast 2 weeks ago. I think it was a Friday. And some people said they liked her, so I might bring her back. But she was telling me about how her son-in-law, how his family, his maternal family, his real family, whatever you want to call them, how when he was playing football, just to give you some background, he was one of those kids who everybody thought was just going to be like a football prodigy. And he was naturally taller than everybody else. His father's 6'6". And when he played football, he was naturally strong. He was strong, fast, you know, all the stereotypes of a Negro. So she was telling me how his whole family, like down there where he lived at, because he lived in Fresno, California, how his whole family used to come out for him and support him. They would bring drinks. They would come out, make sure he got to every game, make sure he got to every practice, make sure he got every pair of sports, the best pair of sports shoes that he needed to play, all that, just everything set for him. And she said that a lot of times, she said she thinks that the reason they were supporting him like that was because in a lot of families, you'll see people support people like that who they feel like is their ticket out of the ghetto. She said she thinks that people, that was how Michael Vick's family was. She said she thinks that's how LeBron James' family was. Like, they saw him as their ticket out of the ghetto, so they kept supporting him. Now, obviously, it didn't work. But the point is I was thinking about that because, it is kind of selfish to look at myself and say, like, man, that's how my family should see me. That's how my family should see me. But in a sense, I got to say, man, like, I feel like that's how they should see me. Like, you see me out here grinding. You see me out here working. You see me out here grinding. So, like, I think it's more of my ego. It's probably more of my ego. But if it's anything, man, it's just, it's like, I always see myself, man, as, like, somebody so weird. Like, I always feel like my ability as a personality, my ability as a podcaster is so obvious. My ability to do this is just so evident. It's obvious to see. I'm always just wondering, like, why is nobody acknowledging this? Like, why is nobody seeing me out here? Like, why ain't nobody taking the time to say, you know what, I should invest in that young man's future, you know? But even with my mom and my dad, nobody really believes in me. But, you know, thank you for listening to me for this long, because it's great to know I got somebody who believes in me. It's always weird, because when I had these late night vlogs, it's always like a weird, like I've said before, like, these are always like either romantic rants or career, or me crying about the lack of progress I've made in my career. But, you know, it is what it is. It's just, at the end of the day, it's just right now, it's just me and you walking and talking. You know, that's one thing I can't wait to get to, is like when I have my own apartment, when I get my own condo and everything like that, fucking apartment, when I get my own condo and everything, I'm going to set it up to where it's going to be a studio room where, you know, it's just going to have like all the newest hardware and stuff like that, you know, big screen monitor, like a actual functioning webcam where I can do the podcast live from YouTube, another one where it's broadcasting live on Periscope. So what I'm going to start doing is I'm literally going to start running myself like a radio station, like in a sense, like just a mass communicator. Like, and when I do it like that, what's going to happen is I'm going to start taking listener calls. I might even start interviewing you. You know, like, is this going to be like a whole, I have this whole vision in my brain, and I can't wait to manifest it. You know, it's weird. It's kind of strange. Like, I don't know. Like, it's kind of strange to see the vision in your brain and be like, man, I'm going to bring it to life. And I just, by December, I want to have my own condo with my own studio room like that. Like, and I just want it so bad. And I know I'm going to manifest it. And I know it's my destiny. I know it's going to happen. You know, and I want it in my house. I just wanted to be mine. And that's one of the parts about manifesting your destiny that can be kind of hard too, is like believing in a vision that nobody else can see for you. You know, like I always tell you when I have these little late night vlogs, like, there's literally nobody else who's working with me on this, but it's just me. But I don't care, because I know this is what I was destined to do. I know this is what I was thrilled to do. I know people can't tell me nothing. I know I know this is where I belong at. So, you know, it is what it is, man. I know this is where I'm supposed to be, and that's all I can say. So, I feel like in this era, you're not going to deny me my greatness. You're not going to deny me that. One thing I forgot to talk to you about, too, also, was yesterday, because I didn't have time to make a late-night vlog, was yesterday I went to Sacramento State University, and I went on campus, and they had a keynote. They had, like, that thing where they had a motivational speaker come on campus and talk to the students and a few older people who decided to get a free event. And when I went there, they had none other than my man Les Brown doing the motivational speaking. And if you do not know who Les Brown is literally one of the highest paid motivational speakers in the world. Speakers, you know, forget the category motivational. One of the highest paid speakers in the world. This man, he's great. He's spoken at T-Mobile events. He's spoken in Canada, Denmark. He's spoken to audience where he had more than 80,000 people in an arena just to hear this man orating. And it was amazing what... When I watched him go on that stage and speak to people, I'm going to be honest. I got to be honest with you, because I feel like if I'm not honest with you, then I'm not being me. When I saw that man walk up on that stage and talk to people, and I felt the fire in his rhetoric, I felt the verbs that he used, I felt the consonants come out of his mouth, I felt everybody's heart just beat up and down. I saw people laugh at his wit. I saw people feel his messages. All I kept thinking was, man, if God would allow me to get on the same stage with this man, they would see how much more talented I am at this than him. You know what I mean? And I hate to sound so cocky, I hate to sound so abrasive, but I just knew it. Like, it's like I always say, like, you can look at somebody, I think as naturally as humans, you and me, anybody, we naturally spend our whole life critical of our skill set. We naturally spend our whole life critical of what we can do, believing we can't do this, believing we're dumb, we're not dumb enough to do that. We're so critical of ourselves that I think we all have an innate ability to see when we perform better at somebody in a certain area. When I saw that man get up there and speak, I knew in my heart I performed better than him in speaking. I knew in my heart that I was more charismatic. I knew in my heart that I was more entertaining. I knew in my heart that I had that fire that Martin Luther King had, that fire that Winston Churchill had, that fire that Marcus Garvey had, that fire that W.E.B. Du Bois had, which he was a writer, but he still had, he had bars in his writing. So anyway, I knew I had that fire. I knew I had that passion to push the people to reach inside themselves and just, like, you know, like, I just feel it, like, I, you don't even know, man, like, it's like, that's why when I, it's like, literally, it's like being a caged bull. Like, there's no other metaphor I can use to describe it to you. It's like being a caged bull. It's like walking around in a zoo, knowing that you're built, walking around in a cage in a zoo, knowing that you're built to fuck shit up. And the only thing that's stopping you is just the circumstances that you're in. But if they let me out this gate, when I bust my way out this gate, when I break my way through this wall, nobody will be able to stop me. That's how I feel right now. Like, I feel like I'm a boxer. I feel like in my own way, with my gift of speech, my gift of communication, I feel like I'm a boxer in a boxing ring, just bouncing up and down, waiting for my opponent, waiting for my opponents, waiting for my opponents. Matter of fact, I'm not waiting for my opponents. That was what I meant to say. My opponents are the people in front of me who are stopping me from getting to where I want to get to. The people in front of me are the gatekeepers. All the walls are just obstacles and BS I got to fight to get to where I want to get to. But I'm going to tell you right now, and I tell those obstacles the same thing, you cannot stop a bull. You cannot stop a bull. You cannot stop a bull. You're not strong enough to stop me. My horns are stronger than yours. My muscles push more weight than you can, and you cannot hold your own against me in any given shape or form. And that's why I did this. That's why I'm an orator. My gift of language, my gift of eloquism, my gift of eloquent speaking, my gift of touching people at the heart. That's why I'm doing this. And there's nobody can stop me and tell me different. So, sorry, I hate to rant on you, but actually, I got off track a little bit, but to get back to the conversation, me and Les Brown, we actually had a conversation. Me and him talked, and you know, we talked. I told him, you know, you're talking to the greatest speaker in the world, except you. Well, maybe a little bit better than you. Got a little bit more juice than you. And he laughed. And he just is like, man, I like your voice. Man, you got a really great voice. I was like, oh, thank you, man. It makes a lot coming from you. But I just told him, man. And I was halfway debating with myself about showing in my podcast, showing my video, showing my YouTube, everything like that. But all I could just tell him was, man, be looking out for me. Be looking out for me. Be looking out for me. My name is JT. Be looking out for me. Be looking out for me. Because you're going to see me again. And that's literally just how I felt. I was just like, man, just look out for me because you're going to see me again. You're going to see me again. Trust me. Only this time I'm going to be on the stage and you're going to be the one sitting at the table below me. Trust me, you're going to see me again. And I liked it and it was a good meeting. The only thing I didn't like about the scenario is that, because I've seen Les Brown speak before, but I never actually got to touch him and talk to him. But the problem with Les Brown is, not even with Les Brown, Les Brown's motivational speeches attract a certain type of demographic that I don't like. They attract the hungry scammers, the scammers entrepreneurs, the people who are trying to scam you, the people who are trying to take advantage of you. And those people I don't like. Like this one woman made me mad. She got my number while I was there. You know, she said she just wanted to connect, just to send me like a bunch of like emails of trying to get her to get me to be a part of her legal firm that she's trying to start. Which I told her, ma'am, I can't focus on that right now. Right now, I'm focusing on my gift and my destiny as a podcaster and a personality. So she told me, well, what if I could show you a better way to get that? I said, ma'am, I'm still focusing on this. And she said, okay, well, you know what? I have some connections that I want to show you, but since you don't want to listen to me, okay. Well, hell, if you have some connections, if you really significantly cared sincerely about me to that extent, why would you even say that to me? That just sounds so, you know what I mean? Like, I hate people like that. Like, I hate manipulators, I hate liars, and I hate people who feel like they can take advantage of me just because I'm young and I'm out here. I just don't like that. So, motor stories is, man, I don't know. I was happy to meet Les Brown. I just don't like swindlers. I hate scammers. I hate these freaking bum businessmen who want to take advantage of us. Want to take advantage of us and use us as like pawns. Like those people who are over those pyramid scheme companies. I hate that. So, I don't know. I mean, that's just my opinion. That's just my opinion. That's just how I operate. Yeah, I'm almost to the crib. I don't know what I'm going to cook. That's one thing. I actually got to start working out better, man. It's not even working out better because I work out a lot. I got to start eating higher quality food. Like, I've just been settling for a lot of junk food lately. That's why when I get paid, I'm going to make sure I get the... I'm making sure when I get paid, I'm getting all food. I'm actually thinking about starting to juice. I might do that really. I'm not even just saying that just to impress you. I really am thinking I'm going to start juicing. Because, you know, why not? You know, I personally, I really don't mind eating food all day. Hell, I don't even mind not eating meat. I just, like I said, just when you broke, when you broke, your options is kind of limited. You feel me? When you broke, your options are quite limited. So I don't know. That's just my opinion. This is the situation I'm in right now. But yeah, that's the coolest thing, man. When I start doing the live podcast shows, I get to start being able to do the live podcast shows, and I'm with my people, and, you know, I come to your city, I come to your town, I come to your college, I come to your job, and there's people out there really just trying to time to meet me and to talk to me. That's going to be the great moments. That's going to be the greatest moment of my life, and that's going to be the moment that I strive for the most. I can't wait for that, man. Those moments where I'm really just in front of thousands of people just talking and just living my life. You know, that's one thing I do like about podcasting is it changed the game. You know, because beforehand, you never saw a person who was a radio personality going to an event and having like almost like a live stand-up comedy show like how podcasters do. But really, like, this is really like when you do podcasts, it's really in and of itself a talk show. And I'm happy that I'm doing this because I look at myself as like the revolutionary in it. So I look at myself as like the revolutionary in it, and It's just weird, like, you know, I spent my whole life trying to be like other people. I spent my whole life, even now, you know, of course I still look up to idols who are in my career field, who are in kind of in the same space that I'm in and who are great, and I look at them and see how great they've been. But I look at them and I'm always thinking, like, I always used to think, like, man, I can't do that. Why come I can't do that? How come I can't do that? I wish I could do that. I wish I could do that. And the reason I bring that up is because you probably, like me, or like you're in a situation sometimes where, you know, you look at people who are, who you perceive as greater than you, and you think, man, they do so good, they do so much better than me. How come they're so much better than me? How come I'm not talented? I used to think that too, but now I'm realizing this. There's no shortage of greatness or talent in the world. I've said this before, I don't believe everybody is like amazingly gifted and talented and all that stuff, but I do think everybody, every single person in this world has a capability. And even if your capability is to be average, nigga, there is not another average person like you in the world. You are the most average person. There's nothing wrong with that. But in all seriousness, man, like, we all have greatness inside of us. We all have certain interests. We all have certain things that define us and make us different from other people. I think the hardest part about that is kind of like figuring out, how can I say this in a nice way? Kind of figuring out how to define ourselves in a way, because it's kind of hard because in one way you shouldn't try to be somebody else, but at the same time, if you're operating in a certain field, whether you want to be a doctor, whether you want to be a carpenter, whether you want to be a chef, to a certain extent you have to study other people, other masters in your field, and understand that take advice from them, take knowledge from them, see what they did that you're doing different, see what mistakes and correct things that they did that you can apply to your own methods. You know, there was some great artist or writer who said, learn the rules so you can rewrite them. I feel like that about everything. Learn the rules so you can rewrite them. Learn the rules so you can rewrite. Well, I guess I can't say rewrite well. Okay, so note that for JT. JT cannot say rewrite correctly. Note that for JT. So, let's move. And I actually just got back to the house right now, at the steps. Whew. It's kind of a walk. It's a 5 mile walk. 5 miles with JT. Well, 2.9 miles, because actually the first half I'd already walked. But with that being said, it's been a pleasure talking to you. It's been a pleasure having a conversation with you. You know, once again, it's great to just know that I can get behind this microphone and talk to you, have a conversation with you, and know that you feel me, that you connect with me, and know it's cool. You know, I love it. So with that being said, my name is JT. It's been a pleasure talking to you. Thank you.